Hello everybody, very warm welcome to St James at Home for our Sunday service on the 13th of June. This is the second Sunday after Trinity. I have no new notices that you can't read in your weekly newsletter, so without further ado, let's begin our worship today. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Give us the joy of your saving help, and sustain us with your life-giving Spirit. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God. Now to that part of the service where we can say sorry to God, we can bring before him all the things that maybe haven't gone so well for us in the last week or so, and is a chance to ask for his forgiveness. So I'm going to say a very short confession, after which there'll be a short silence where you may like to bring your own thoughts to the Lord, and then the absolution. So let us pray. For all the times we have forgotten those who reach out to help us, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. For all the times we have not tried to follow Jesus, Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. For all the times we have not listened to those who need us, Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. May the God of love bring us back to himself, forgive us our sins, and assure us of his eternal love in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord our God, Creator and Redeemer of all. To you be glory and praise forever. From the waters of chaos you drew forth the world, and in your great love fashioned us in your image. Now, through the deep waters of death, you have brought your people to new birth by raising your Son to life in triumph. May Christ, your light, ever dawn in our hearts as we offer you our sacrifice of thanks and praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. I'm going to invite you to join in with me in a canticle for today. It's a canticle that you would normally find in your green service books, called A Song of David. And I invite you to join in the words with me. Blessed are you, God of Israel, for ever and ever. For yours is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty. Everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head over all. Riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. In your hand are power and might. Yours it is to give power and strength to all. And now we give you thanks, our God, and praise your glorious name. For all things come from you, and of your own have we given you. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns his face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
Behold the man upon a cross, my
until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom.
The reading is taken from Paul's letter to Corinthians, the second letter, chapter 5, beginning at verse 6. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please Him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due to us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. Since then we know what it is to fear the Lord, we try to persuade others. What we are is plain to God, and I hope it is also plain to your conscience. We are not trying to commend ourselves to you again, but are giving you an opportunity to take pride in us, so that you can answer those who take pride in what is seen rather than what is in the heart. If we are out of our mind, as some say, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So, from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hello, everyone. While I was preparing this sermon, I looked first, of course, at the gospel reading. But it seemed to me there wasn't a lot I perhaps wanted to say particularly or felt called to say from the gospel. And so I turned to the set lectionary reading for the epistle from 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I hope you were listening very carefully when the epistle was read to us. One Bible scholar says of this passage, and I quote, "It's one of the most difficult in the whole of Paul's letters. Well, thank you, lectionary. Now, far be it from me to say that I have all the answers, because I know I don't. But I'll try to apply what Paul is saying to our daily lives. To start, Paul is contrasting our relationship with God on earth with what it will be like in heaven. I wonder if Paul might have been following the Euros football games at the time, because he writes, at least in the Revised Standard Version translation, whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please the Lord. This contrast between earthly and heavenly life made me think. When Jane, my wife, and I were engaged, I was studying in Bristol and she was studying in London. I had no phone at home, and it was well before the time of mobile phones. And if I went up the road to the local call box, I knew it wouldn't be long before someone else would be tapping on the glass wanting to use the phone. So I often walked from my home in Easton several miles into the city centre, because I knew there was a whole rank of about 8 or 10 phone boxes. I went along armed with a pile of coins. But by the time that someone at Jane's hostel had taken up the call and gone to find her, and she'd come back, my first tranche of coins would have run out. Fortunately, I always took plenty of coins with me. But I was happy because I could talk to her. I knew she was there and okay. And I knew that one day we would be together. Paul is telling us we have a friendship with God now, but it will be so much better one day when we are really together in heaven. But then Paul gets into this internal debate about whether we should want to be in heaven right now instead of being here on earth. I knew a vicar and his wife. They had 2 young sons at the time, and they told me that they simply couldn't wait to get to heaven. Now that's great in theory, but personally, I'm not in any hurry. We are here on earth now, and God is with us, not in any limited way, as in a phone call, but in the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. God is not just with us in our times of worship or Bible reading in prayer, but God is with us every moment of every day. So let's make the most of our friendship with God while we're here on earth, and let's remind ourselves and be encouraged by the glorious future that awaits us. Now Paul goes on to point out that we need to be working with God, doing what he wants us to do. How do we succeed at doing what God wants us to do? For example, I would love to be good at golf, as one member of the congregation to which I belong is. But I'm absolutely terrible at golf, as with most sports I've tried. Football, cricket, archery, rounders. I'm equally terrible at all of them. And I haven't found the sport yet that I am in any way adequate at. If I took part in the Masked Dancer on television, you'd identify me immediately by the appalling ability I showed. How could I possibly improve in any of these things? Or perhaps if I had a trainer. And of course, as Christians, we do have the Holy Spirit as our guide and, if you like, as our trainer to make us more like Christ. But we have to want to improve. We have to want to please the Lord at home or away. His presence alone with us won't change us. We have to want to be Christ disciples, to be willing to be and do whatever he asks of us. Then Paul writes about every Christian appearing one day before the judgment of Christ. But hang on, I hear you saying, surely we are put right with God as Christians through our faith in Jesus' death on the cross. So how can we possibly be judged? We're certainly not put right by the good things we do. It's only through our faith in Jesus. How can we face judgment? Well, that is certainly true. But what Paul is writing is that, well, to put it this way, in my imagination, if you like, one day Jesus will look back in our lives with us at the things we've said and done, and then he'll say, well, the ultimate performance review. We won't be sent away, but we'll all wish we'd done better. There's a story of a master builder. He was asked by a good friend to build him the best house ever, with the finest materials and sparing no cost. But the builder was nearing retirement and he wanted to make some extra money. So he built the house with the cheapest materials he could find. It would look wonderful to begin with, but then the door frames would warp, the windows and the roof would leak, and the house would be a nightmare to live in. The builder showed his friend the completed house. His friend said to him, because you've been so good to me over the years, I asked you to build this house so I could give it to you as my gift. You must live in it from now on. The moral is, we all have to live with our decisions. So how do we live? How do we behave? What is our motivation in life? Well, Paul writes, the love of Christ controls us. The love of Christ controls us. He also writes, we regard no one from a human point of view. We regard no one from a human point of view. In other words, because we are motivated by God's love, his love for us, his love for others, we don't view other people from a self-regarding position. We don't say, are they as good as me? Do they deserve my help? What can I get out of this situation? A retired vicar told me that he was very concerned about his son because his son was in the police force. I said, well, that's a splendid vocation for anyone. I admire your son. He said, sadly, his son had become very cynical, seeing everyone is untruthful and dishonest. And the vicar said he was certain in his own mind it was a result of his occupation as a police officer. Now I'm certain that the vast majority of police officers, men and women, are not at all like that. Just as I'm sure not all clergy are looking for an easy life or wanting to do a job to boss people around, even though there may be odd exceptions. Possibly every occupation, every personality type comes with weaknesses and temptations to be guarded against. And the question I ask myself, and perhaps you might like to ask yourself, what temptations, what presuppositions am I tempted to fall into? But if we want to be the best we can be for God, and I'm sure we do want to be the best we can be, we must recognize that we are a new creation, that God has made us over anew, and we must see everyone in a different light. God loves them just as much as he loves us. How can we be as Christ to them? How can we do for them what God wants us to do? We can only discover that for ourselves as we allow God to speak to us and as we are willing to follow what he says. So what then do I take from this difficult passage? Well, that God loves me and that one day I will be with him in heaven. That God is with me now and that he wants me to know his presence every day. And that God will equip me if I am willing to serve him in his world. It's obvious I don't have all the answers, but if I'm ever confused, at least I know who to ask. May God bless you in your walk with him today and in eternity. Thank you. Amen.
You are my hiding place.
And in response to those wonderful words from the reading and our sermon, let's affirm our faith together. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Lord, as our world's leaders meet in Cornwall this week, we ask you to be with them and give them strength and courage in their decision-making as they look to supporting the world's poorer countries and their vaccine programmes, and as they look to managing climate change. You have given us such a wonderful world in which to live, and we pray you will give wisdom to those whose decisions will determine how we look after our planet. Continue to pray for those impacted by COVID-19, whether through illness or loss, isolation or poor mental health. We also pray especially for all those on our prayer list this week. We thank you for all those who have worked within our communities to support those isolated and all those who continue to work for our NHS. As we continue to enjoy this beautiful weather, we are thankful for the opportunities it affords to reconnect with families and friends outdoors. Lord, we pray for our young people who have undergone so much change and disruption over the past year. We ask that you be with them and support them as they begin to return to normality and help them to recover the lost time in their education and social contact. Pray for your Christian church throughout the world, and especially for churches and places where religious faith is suppressed. We pray for the Church of St James and our community of Mangotsfield, Emerson's Green and Live Green. We ask you to be with our leadership team as they continue to deliver your word through so many different mediums during these extraordinary times. Amen.
As we remain in an attitude of prayer, may we say together the prayer that Jesus himself taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. May the God who calls us to live in his love be close to us. May the Son who showed us the way lead us. May the Spirit who strengthens us with joy encourage us. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us and those we love, today, this week, and always. Amen.